Ladies and gentlemen, our last session is Tech Talk, Creating a Platform for Integrated Logistics Solution. Please join me in welcoming our chair, Shri Anant Swarup, Joint Secretary, Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India. A round of applause, please, ladies and gentlemen. Our lead speaker, Shri Ved Prakash, General Manager, DFCCIL. And our panel, Srimati Rajini Hasija, Director Tourism, IRCTC. Shri Atul Holkar, Senior Vice President, Supply Chain Management, Varun Beverages Limited, PepsiCo. Shri Rajkiran Kanagala, Group Head, Business Development, TCI Group. And Mr. Deepankar Sinha, Head International Trade Operation and Logistics Division, Indian Institute of Foreign Trade. I welcome the panel on behalf of CILT and EI Group. It's my honor to introduce our Honorable Chair, Shri Anant Swarup. Shri Swarup has over 25 years of work experience in one of the world's largest logistics organization, the Indian Railway. He has a rich experience in handling trade issues, trade remedies, intellectual property rights, as well as human resource management and logistics and supply chain. He has served on illustrious assignments like the Executive Director in the Railway Minister's Office and the Permanent Mission of India to the World Trade Organization in Geneva. Shri Swarup has also handled important trade issues like North America Free Trade Agreement, India's trade relations with Latin America and ASEAN. He holds a master's degree in science and business administration and a bachelor's degree in law. I invite our Honorable Chair to kindly take over the session.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this last session. You all had a very tiring day today, and we promise that we'll be on time. This session is on creating a platform for integrated logistics solution. We have with us the lead speaker, Mr. Ved Prakash, General Manager, DFCCIL, the next big thing which is about to be created in the logistics space. We have Srimati Rajini Hasija, Director Tourism, IRCTC, which is already making waves with its very successful IPO. Mr. Atul Holkar, Vice President, Supply Chain Management, Varun Beverages, which is the sole beverage provider, PepsiCo, in India. We have Shri Rajkiran Kanagala, Group Head, Business Development, Transport Corporation of India. Mr. Deepankar Sinha is Head, International Trade Operations and Logistics, Indian Institute of Foreign Trade. He's also working with the Department of Commerce. We have created a new center for trade facilitation and logistics, and Mr. Deepankar Sinha is closely associated with that. Before I invite the lead speaker, Shri Ved Prakash, let me give you just a small background to this. The topic today, which we will be discussing, is creating a platform for integrated logistics solution. India has the second highest network of road, third or fourth largest railway network. We have got 7,500 kilometers of coastline. We have got now 111 inland waterways, but still our logistics costs continue to remain high. And one of the reasons is the lack of integration amongst different modes and non-promotion of multimodality. So today's topic is all about an integrated approach to logistics. How do we create a platform which provides that integration? And we talk about a platform, it is not necessarily a digital platform which could be created. It could also be a physical platform where different modes come together and provide you service. There's a study done by the Ministry of Road called LEAP, Logistic Efficiency Enhancement Program, on which the Bharatmala Yojana is all based on. It also talks about creating multimodal logistic hubs in the country. One big idea, which I, as I mentioned, is about the dedicated freight corridor. And this freight corridor also would ride on the backbone of multimodality. So with this background, now I'll request Shri Ved Prakash, General Manager, Dedicated Freight Corridor, for his address.
As he rightly said, creating a platform, integrated logistic solution, is both digital and physical. And DFC is the physical answer to that. Everyone knows that golden collateral and its diagonal connecting all the metros, Delhi, Kolkata, Chennai, and Mumbai, is very congested. And out of this, the railway contribution is 16% of the whole railway network. And it carries 52% of the passengers and 58% of the freight. While the roadways of this network is only 0.5% and it carries 40% of the total freight traffic. And that is why the Government of India has decided to make dedicated freight corridors connecting all the ports of Gujarat and Maharashtra to Northern Belt and connecting West Bengal and Jharkhand mineral-rich region to the consumption center of Bihar, UP, Delhi, Punjab, and Haryana. The other future corridors are East-West Corridor, Kolkata to Mumbai, North-South Corridor, Delhi to Chennai, and East Coast Corridor, Kharagpur to Vijayawada. DFC design itself is supporting the integrated logistics. The wagon here can have a wider and higher size, so that over-dimension consignment, double stack container, and roll on roll off can move on. Tracks are heavier and faster. Stations loop are longer. It is 1.5 kilometer. Signaling are safer. TPWS and everything is there. And bridges are futuristic. They can carry 32.5 ton axle load. Moving dimension is such that over-dimension what is in the railway can we run in the DFC section at the speed of 100 kmph. If you see the height of the wagons, in Indian Railway it is only 4.265 meters allowed, while in DFC, in the Eastern Corridor, it is 7.1 meter. And in Eastern DFC, it is 5.1 meter. Width is, it is half a meter wider than the Indian Railway current wagon condition. Container, double stack container in Western DFC. Train length is 1.5 kilometer and total tonnage in DFC, one can carry 13,000 ton, means offloading 1,300 trucks at a time. The axle load is quite high here, 25 ton axle load. It means in each wagon, DFC can carry 80 ton, while in Indian Railway condition, it can carry 67 to 71 ton. The speed is high, 100 kmph. The average speed in DFC will be something around 65 to 70, while in Indian Railway it is only 24.7. The gradient is 1:200, means it is lesser steeper than faster movement can take place. Traction is 2 into 24 kV system. So that the heavier load can move with the maximum speed. Really, DFC is a game changer. It will have a faster, longer, and heavy haul trains. It will be a quantum jump in the transport capacity. 2 into 120 trains each direction, long haul if we carry. Compared to the Indian Railway, they can move only 40 trains in one direction for goods train and 40 mail express. That's why this will be a major jump for the transport freight sector. Connectivity to the private sidings, industrial corridors, PFTs, MMLPs, major and minor ports, and 37 connectivity with the Indian Railway system will make it available to go to any place. In DFC, we will run timetable trains to strengthen the supply chain. induction of modern technologies in train operation, improved safety features like TPWS, and both the corridors, we have industrial corridor, DMICDC in western corridors, basically Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor, and Amritsar-Kolkata in eastern corridor. Connectivity proposals, we have already private freight PFTs 9, freight sidings 13, and port rail connectivity 5, new goods sets 5, and existing goods sets 5. Directly, DFC will connect with the JNPT, with Hajira Port, Nagarwal Port, and JSW Nandgaon Port. While Mudra Port, Kandla Port, Dahej, connectivity will be via feeder route of IR. This is the brownfield MMLPs are already with along the DFC route, the Concord Katwas and Concord Dadri. And the new one will come out, Navakar Terminal at PFT in Western Corridors, Concord ICD Varnama, and DMICD Sanand, Concord Swarup Ganj, Concord PFT Fulera, and Concord Prithala, Concord DMICDC at Dadri, and SFA Logistic at Dankuni. Similarly, greenfield sidings will be Nilje, New Meerut, New Sambhu, New Tundla, and New Mirzapur. And the old one is already there, which will shift into the DFC, is New Mughalsarai, New Kalanur, New Pilkani, New Mandi Govindgarh, and New Khanna. Along with this, large number of powerhouses will be related to us. Nabha TPS, Amtek Sarding, Jawahar TPS, Araya TPS, Meja TPS, Inland Waterways Authority of India's MMLP at Banaras, it will be connected with us. BPCL PUL siding at Mughalsarai and Ultratech Dankuni Sail Complex in Dankuni. Basically, with excellent transport link, long-haul rail network and delivery points in the catchment area by road will be the DFC norms. Custom clearance facility will be there, around the clock services away from the urban settlement area. Cost saving, all the facilities are to be provided at one location. More option, competitive and reliable logistic providers will be there. New generation of freight terminals with value added services to serve as warehousing, distribution and trading hubs, and complete transport solution to customers. Aim is less logistic costs and less inventory requirements. The transit time will come down drastically. Mumbai-Delhi, it will be less than 24 hours. Timetable trains are guaranteed transit. Total logistic solution, including value-added services through logistic parks, enable special wagons, handling facilities like bulk cement, liquid cargo. Enable movement of special stocks like ODC, attract new cargo like automobiles, terminal and strategic locations to operate as a hub for different products. Each station of DFC will work as a parcel hub or a small hub, what Indian Railways has lost, with a daily timetable assured clearance and delivery. That's the mandate of DFC that we are going to do. And the plan of completion is basically Khurja-Bhavpur is by March 2020. Out of that 194 kilometer, we are already running the trains. Till date, we have run more than 500 trains. Rewari-Palanpur, 641 kilometer. Madar, this month we will start Madar to Rewari, while Rewari-Palanpur will start from March 2020. Overall target commissioning of the Eastern and Western DFC is 2021. Till date, 65% capex has been invested and 68% progress of physical progress is there. The best point is the land acquisition, 98.5% is already there. DFC is all set for giving the facilities. I will like to show a small film that we are running on 194 kilometer. This is basically for the first time long haul trains ran between Kolkata and Delhi. And we have inked a memorandum of understanding with the Australian University, Wanglong, for research in heavy haul. This will further help reducing the unit cost of transportation over DFCCIL routes. Thank you. This is basically 103 wagon. First time loaded wagon in from Allahabad region to Delhi area we have run. Earlier, the long haul were made by Indian Railway, only empties they have made. These are the basically control center, OCC. This is the world-class OCC so that we can have a timetable trains, we can monitor the speeds and all. This is in Allahabad, and one will be for the western at Ahmedabad. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ved Prakash. So Mr. Ved Prakash gave us what's happening on integrated development of logistics on the physical side. Now let's listen to Mr. Rajkiran. He'll tell us what's happening on connectivity integration on the softer side, on the digital areas. So Mr. Rajkiran.
Good evening. So thanks a lot, Mr. Swarup, and to CILT for giving us this chance. And a wonderful presentation, Mr. Ved Prakash. I think everyone is looking forward to the change. Only one point. We know Mr. Swarup quite well, so we'll always like to little bit, sort of trigger some more challenges to him, which the logistics ministry and him solve it. The catch is the arterial network is not thought of. You can create the best in class 103 wagons to carry bulk and containers, but when you come out of Katwas and try to hit, the city hits immediately. So you can do the best of the rail network, but if your arterial roads don't support the rail, you are going to see another JNPT. So I'd like to leave that thought with DFIC, is that end of the day, it is an end-to-end logistics which matters. End of the day, we all as consumers need the product in hand to consume. So what is logistics? End of the day, origin to consumption, not origin to destination. So that's something which I'd like to leave it with Mr. Ved Prakash. We also had been a part of the discussions with DFSL, but this problem remains. In fact, we're going to choke up our arterial routes. But with this, I'd like to start covering on what's happening on the digital space, and when you say integrated, how does it look? So to begin with, let's look at old times. So I represent the logistics service provider fraternity. We typically have seen these pictures, and this picture, believe, was good for us. We could always tell stories to customers that the cargo aa raha hai, nahi ja raha hai, ho jayega, kyun aap worry kar rahe ho. So sab hum bhagwan pe chhod dete. There was no transparency, and there was nothing which we could predict. But what are we seeing now? And now the expectations is that we are typically saying that we only will believe the robots, the artificial intelligence and machine language to tell, because we are in the world of Amazons and Flipkarts. So this is the paradigm what has happened in the logistics sector, primarily due to the digital framework. What we'll be doing, we'll be seeing the growth story of India and the way digitization has panned out in the last few years. It's not far off, it's just 4 years ago. Look at the statistics, I'm not going to read, but it also compares two parameters, A, India's GDP, and B, the rail and road mix, and what happened typically in terms of the economy. We move to 2017, everybody knows, a monumental year, GST came in, and suddenly everybody started talking of networking with the GST and platform. How do I network with GST and platform? And the size of logistics, and the ministry started saying that our cost of doing business is high, our logistics cost is high. 2018, e-way bill came in, and we again started saying e-way bill is a problem. For the first time, Mr. Swarup and team started talking about, along with MORTH, AIS-140 standard, which is a GPS standard nationally to be adopted by truck manufacturers as well as by logistics people. Let's look at the landscape. We started talking of digitization. E-commerce started hitting us. We started talking of applications. On an app, we could order something, we could get something, we could visualize the order and delivery. We started seeing venture capitals funding logistics startups. Big, $100 million was common. So this is what happened the last 4 years. Let's see what now we are seeing typically in the entire logistics plan to delivery. There's a talk, this is under pilot, that you will have a set of GPS service providers, and Mr. Swarup can add here, who are going to be mandated to ensure that everything is tracked and traced. So this is something which where every truck manufacturer will put it. It's already started in heavy vehicles, and every logistics service provider, whether you do the first mile, last mile, or the middle mile as it's called now, you need to have the visibility. So this is coming as a standard, not that it is a whims and fancies of a service provider or the manufacturer. RFID, there's an offshoot of DFCCIL, which is into creating a network of RFID through NEC of Japan, wherein they are monitoring tags of container coming into port and out of port across the country. So a major part of India is covered. So that's the RFID tracking what is happening of each Exim container, and including domestic containers it started. So the coastal containers also are being tagged. So we have our own 10,000 coastal Indian based containers. They all are getting tags so that when they leave the port and come into the port, it's tracked. We are talking of onboard devices, like temperature being monitored through the temperature devices. API with weather portals. More and more prediction is coming in. A lot of people will know. You can actually buy a Google license, not the free one, but you go for a Google license, you also get a weather input, which helps us to predict which route you are going to see an issue. Like recently we had the cyclone Bulbul. We actually could predict that we should not send trucks into Calcutta. Let's put it at the border near Jharkhand. That's one. Second was also when the whole state of Kashmir opened up, how do we ensure that we are panic out because there was snow. So how do you ensure? So this kind of inputs from trusted sources is coming in. Conveyor and sorting systems with advent of large parcels. So any idea how many parcels we handle in e-commerce? Anybody a guess? There are a lot of bags and prizes out here. So Mr. Swarup, I'm sure we can add or something. So quickly, it's 1.5 million packages on an average we handle per day. And here is China. China handles 15 million parcels per day, and it's only growing. And you take the billion day, the figure is astronomical. So we are talking equal population, and look at the difference, 1.5 million to 15 million. And that's you're going to do with an integrated logistics platform, with DFSL one side, with the physical infrastructure, but most importantly, the digital infrastructure. We started talking of omni-channel. A lot of you would have heard, but quickly to some students and a lot of people who've been new. Previously, there was a distribution center and delivery. We now are saying that a store can deliver anywhere, a DC can deliver anywhere, inventory can lie anywhere. So today, warehouses are being built to address all channels. You cannot say, my inventory is for e-commerce, my inventory is for a big bazaar kind of retail or a traditional channel. Your inventory can be anywhere, you can service an order. That's typically an omni-channel platform, put simply. So this is what we are going to see more and more. Of course, the digitization of e-way bill. This, I said physical, it's already been covered. Another part which Mr. Swarup mentioned was on Sagarmala. The fact that the factory will go to the port and you will send out the goods from the port or get an import is going to be order of the day. You cannot have factories only in the interland and you do a 1,000 kilometer inbound or outbound in the logistics network. It's a high cost. So if you want to bring the cost from the claimed 13%, you need to move factories which are dependent on import-export closer to port. So Mundra port is one example. You will see a lot of factories coming up at Mundra port. JNPT is not. So this is the dichotomy that since a port was created way back and a port is new and more of a private port, you are seeing a better adoption of factories near ports. Now let's see what's happening next. I started with a slide 4 years back. Let's see what's happening. Lot of big talk. We are saying we're going to be a $5 trillion economy. Lot of you people would have read in this Sunday's Economic Times, FASTag from December 1st, every vehicle will have to have a FASTag, all commercial passenger. All our cars are coming when we buy a new car, pre-built FASTag. So you are going to see a cashless FASTag coming in. That's an integrated platform. That data is being used somewhere. I'm sure the ministry will have a lot of such nice data to use. The new CMVR rules, a lot of UN cry, but safety and safety through digitization is something which we're going to speak of. BS6 implementation, it's again a technology change. It's there. We are going to look at something which I don't want to talk being in Delhi with respect to climate and environment. It's a taboo subject, but BS6 will help it because we're going to look at cleaner fuel and better engines. And self-automated vehicles, would request you to go through a website of a Swedish company called as Enride. You can note down E-N-R-I-D-E. You can see what's happening. They are created already automated trucks which can perform in closed circuit. What is a closed circuit? Ports, mines, in ICDs, and they don't need a driver. It can carry 16 tons successfully, and that pilot is already going on and tested. So it's not far off that closed circuits will have an electric vehicle, no driver, and it enables us to ensure that we take care of the climate also. So what's there? Digitization is the order of the day. Most of you are still on phones while listening to us. That happens. We also do that. Warehousing automation. We are not saying that the person goes to the goods. The goods are coming to the person. So very soon, goods will come to the person just to pack. The large multinationals are doing that. It's a high investment, but coming up. And I covered automated vehicles. Finally, who are these? Are they humans or robots? Any guess? Yes, this is what they showed in China TV. This is what we should gear up. This is what we wish to leave, that when we talk of a digital integrated platform, which is a subject, it is going to be all round, connecting the dots in terms of the physical, in terms of the information and the document flow, in fact, impacting our lives. And we might be either adapted to it or we might look like a dinosaur. With this, thank you very much. Thanks for hearing out. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rajnikant, for giving us a broad overview of what's happening on the digital space and how digitally we are getting integrated. We have talked a lot about cargo, and now is the time to talk about passenger logistics also. And when we talk about passengers, what best other than IRCTC? So may I now request Mrs. Rajini Hasija to tell us, how are you integrating, especially the passenger ticketing, and also what is happening on integration about passenger grievances, cleanliness, better quality of service, catering, etc. So far, so that we are using technology to provide better service to our passengers.
Good evening, everyone. I was wondering, in the field of logistics, how come the passenger dealing people have been called? Suddenly I realized that passenger is also a commodity to be carried. So carrying, yes, IRCTC has been doing this work very successfully. IRCTC was born in the year 1999, but our first carrying of the passenger started with the carriage of the tourist. Later on, in the year 2002, we came up with our e-commerce portal, that is irctc.co.in, which is now Asia's biggest website, and it is including Japan. So the load that we carry is very huge, but carrying this much load is also a task, and it is much more what the logistic companies can do. Managing this side during the peak hours when the tatkal load is there is also a challenge for us. So we have been handling this challenge since ages. Yes, there are downfalls on few occasions when the rush is there, when the festival season is there. The site now no longer crashes. We are handling the load. But at times we have some glitches, technical glitches are there. To facilitate the carriage of passengers, since we had already provided the platform in the B2C segment, the task was to proliferate in the B2B segment. And we did a very good job by coming up with the various scheme, and after tying up with the government schemes, we have many government, state governments have their CSC units, and with the defense personnels, where they are carrying many people in the war on the basis of warrants. And the lot of manpower was being wasted in handling the warrants at both the ends, at the railways end and at the defense end also. So we could bring these, we could convert these warrants into the e-warrants, and we built a platform for both the ends. Now we are seamlessly handling the ticketing, though that may be our e-warrants at their end for CRPF, for BSF we are going to start, for National Security Guard also we have been able to handle. And for CSC agents, every state has a facilitation counters, CSC agents, where you might be knowing that Ministry of MIT has issued the guidelines that each state has to have few CSEs which will be dealing with all kind of facilities, Janam, Mrityu, Pramanan Patra, like where railway ticketing is also one of the part. There we have been able to integrate those CSEs with our ticketing platform, which was a huge task, because going into masses was not easy for us. So we, in the e-governance project of Government of India, we tied up with all the CSEs, all the state governments, and could bring all of them in the one platform. So for around 2.8 lakh centers are planned to be integrated with us with our e-ticketing platforms. As of now, we are handling 72% of the total country load of ticketing. The story is not ending. In addition to what we have handled earlier, we have done many digital promotions, and we have also facilitated our sites. So like talkback features have been provided, push notifications have also been provided, chatbot solution has been provided, just to facilitate the customer and bringing the digital technology near to customer. It is our job not only to bring the seamless transactions, but also to have a very good interface for the pub-based app. Similarly, on the same pattern as we have done in the iOS, so the customer doesn't get confused. So bringing and retaining the customer on our platform has been a challenge for us.
Thank you for giving us this broad perspective, what's happening on the passenger area. Mr. Rajkiran talked about what's happening on the digital space. It's said that Internet of Things, blockchain coming up, then automation which is happening, they are going to change the way we do logistics in the world. So now I would like to listen to Mr. Atul, that what's your take on the new technologies which are coming up, be it Internet of Things, be it artificial intelligence, be it blockchain, and how will it impact the logistics industry, especially the FMCG sector? So your perspectives on that.
I'll take the mic. Yeah, sure. Thank you. Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A small correction in my name, and it is Colonel Atul Holkar. And being in the corporate for quite some time now, I have got used to. Wherever I speak in any forum or any of the colleges or institutes, first thing which I do in honor of my organization is that I request the audience to give a big hand to the services officers and jawans who are deployed on the borders of the India. Right? They're doing a great service, and because of them that we sit here in a very cozy environment and think about how India should be growing. I have nearly 33 years of experience in supply chain management, both from the Indian Army and the corporate, worked in four continents of the world, studied in many institutes across the world, including India. I would, in fact, take the cue from Mr. Rajkiran. And Rajkiran actually took us just few years back, and that was around 4 to 5 years back. I will take you billions of years back. And why I want to do is I want to build a context of what is exactly happening in technology. Earth came into existence 4.5 billion years ago. Homo as a genus came into existence 1.5 million years ago. Fire as a daily use happened only 3 lakh years back. It's only 70,000 years back Homo sapiens moved from Africa to start moving across the world, including Australia. The known civilization is just about 12,000 years back, where first settlements were seen. The coinage usage came 5,000 years back. Christianity on today's date is exactly 2019 years old. Islam is 1400 years old. Sikhism is 550 years old. Industrial Revolution happened 200 years back, not very far behind. The second Industrial Revolution happened 100 years back when you had the manufacturing lines and electricity being used for that. 40 years back, the computers came into our day-to-day usage. The Industry 4.0 is in offing, and Government of India is incentivizing the industries to use every possible means to convert to Industry 4.0. Look at the technology. In our lifetime, we have already moved from 2G to likelihood of 5G. The phone called iPhone was of premium just about 10 years back. And we don't even look what model are they launching now. What my entire aim of building this context is, the technology is moving much faster than we can anticipate. In a lot of forums, people tell me, this is India. And I must tell you, this is India, and we will move much faster than the world has moved. Because at most of the places, we are leapfrogging by taking over the best of the technology. Right? What is happening now, which is forcing us to look into the logistic industry, and that is going to happen now to next 10 years. And wherever I teach in terms of logistics and supply chain, I tell people, the knowledge which you are gaining now is going to be outdated in exactly 8 years. What you learn in 8 years will be outdated in 4 years. And it is moving double the speed we can even anticipate. And what is driving all this? It's the technology that is driving. Every part of logistics, and I can tell you how it has developed. So around 12,000 years back, when they first time started getting into agriculture, what was being grown was wheat. So when they created wheat, they wanted something to store. What Gandhiji used to say is, gaon should be capable of looking after itself. But the villages started producing more than they could consume. So they had to transfer. By doing that, the transportation started. So we used to call those people truckwala or transporter. Slowly, godams were created because obviously material had to be stored. After that, we started calling these gentlemen as logistics people because now there was a match between the trucking, the warehousing, distribution. Now, after some time, we realize that there is a procurement that is happening, there is a forecasting that's happening, there's a demand planning that's happening, manufacturing, distribution, and in some cases, like our business of PepsiCo, we also get into reverse logistics of bringing the glass back into the industry for refilling. So they created something called supply chain management. The supply chain management, thank you, sir. Supply chain management has now moved to value chain management. I'll just give you one example, and the gentleman from the Government of India is there. You must watch, why is US fighting China and why is US fighting the trade war? Is suddenly the Americans have stopped consuming the Chinese product? Or they are thinking that we don't need them? Or we can negotiate and bring the prices better? That's just part of it. Now the Americans are aware, with the use of technology, they can have smaller factories with much lesser cost inside United Nations states. So they don't need outsourcing anymore. Gone are the days of having manufacturing hub across the world. They know they can do that at their own place, and they can have a mass customization. Mera wala pink. I can create a phone for my requirement. There are so many youngsters in this audience who are sitting. When do the shopping start every day? I am a youngster, so I can tell you, it starts at 9 p.m. in the evening, when we all are free and go back to our laptops. And what do? We go to Amazon, we go to Myntra, we go to Snapdeal, and we are doing that. And we punch one order, and we expect tomorrow in the morning, the door should open and the package should be there. Or agar wo ek din late ho jaye, then the God have it. I mean, the Amazon know how to deal with people like us because they always know it takes 3 days, they will tell you 4 days, and just one day prior they tell you it's coming early. That's all planned, right? So what is happening is the entire consumer behavior is changing. And the consumer is dictating how the rest of the world needs to move. With that, the industry is changing, and that industry is forcing the logistics to change. When I was in the army, the general used to decide where he needs to attack, what he needs to capture. So he would say, we would capture Tiger Hill by 0500 hours, 22nd November. After that, he'll look over me and say, Atul, plan your logistics. Now I can't go back to him and say, sir, wo north se nahi jayenge. I can't give you from there. Or let's go from south, because his only objective is to win. And I, as a logistician, needs to ensure he wins. More or less, same concepts happen even in the corporate. But only thing is, here I also advise him as CEO in the cost that it will involve and the services which he's expecting on a particular track. So the supply chain guy becomes that much more important. Now with this entire complexity that is happening in the world, I need to know few things. What is my cost? Where is my product? And what will be the level of services and the satisfaction of consumer? All the technologies, and if I can start counting, right from drone to IoT to artificial intelligence to analytics to data mining to virtual reality, augmented reality, blockchain, every one of these technology is only answering that one thing which a logistician needs: where is my product and at what cost? So all of us who are sitting here and think that in coming future we can de-link ourselves from the technology, I think we would not be required then. As far as integrated transportation is concerned, we took the advantage, Mr. Swarup, recently. We have moved certain trial runs of PepsiCo products on the coastal route. So 3 days back, my product from Pathankot has moved to Palakkad via western coastal route. And first time in my company we did that we moved the product through shipping lane. And that was a preform, which is the basic packaging material for creating a plastic bottle. So we said, agar ye kharab bhi nahi hoga, time bhi lag jayega, doesn't matter. But then we wanted to be a little bit more adventurous and said, let's move finished goods, because that is sensitive to time. It can lead to expiry. It can get damaged. We can have losses. So what we did is we moved Tropicana again from Pathankot to Goa. And successfully, again, the ship came at the same time. At the right time, came out. We had a 40-foot container at the gate. And suddenly factory says, humne to gate itna bada banaya hi nahi tha iske liye. Right? I said, no problem. Gate ke bahar khada karo, back to back, unload karo, but move. Right? Another thing which we have done is, we have moved our product from Haldia to Brahmaputra, first time crossing international border via Bangladesh. Right? So we in industry are the first to adapt and adopt both whatever the facilities the government is creating for us and the technology to make money. We are in such intense competitive environment and forced by the consumer that there is no other solution than to adopt to the best technology. Just giving you one example, when I came here, there was a Kinle bottle. Who makes Kinle? Any idea? Coca-Cola makes Kinle. And a guy who's sitting there of Pepsi can't have a Coca-Cola bottle on his table. You can't picture me with that. So I had to remove that bottle. So that is the level of intense competition we have in the corporate world. So my, you know, closing comments would be that this is the world. It's changing very fast. It's time that we become part of this changing world. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Colonel, for giving us this broad overview of what's happening on the digital space and how are you using integrated solutions to your supply chain management. It is said that for any project to succeed, you have to have a triple helix model where government, decision makers, we had Mr. Ved Prakash, industry, we have Colonel Holkar, Rajini, and Rajkiran, and also academia. If all three together sit and then decide, it's bound to succeed. So with that triple helix model in view, we have with us Dr. Deepankar Sinha from the Indian Institute of Foreign Trade. And I'll request Dr. Sinha to tell us what's your take, what's your research tells us, what's going to happen on logistics with integrated logistics, with so much of technology and integration happening in the coming years.
A very good evening to the dignitaries, delegates, ladies and gentlemen. I thank CILT and the chair of the session, Sri Arun Swarup ji, for giving me this opportunity to talk before the August gathering. As he said very nicely, that we need to find out what is the blend of what government thinks, industry expects, and what academy proposes. Now, in the morning when I attended the inaugural session, the key word that I gathered from the keynote speaker, the Honorable Minister for State Road Transport, that just in time is the key word to the army, and so it is so for the industry. Like the previous speaker said, that you place an order in the night and you expect in the morning. So that is what is expected in today's day's time. And that is what is the focus, is the shrinking supply time. And that shrinking supply time can be achieved through increasing the speed of delivery. And when you talk of increasing the speed of delivery, there are two distances that needs to be covered. One is obviously the physical distance that we need to cover to reach the ultimate consumer or customer, and not just the destination or the port. There we have taken a lot of things in our stride. We have come across the dedicated freight corridor. There's one attempt to that. We are talking about hub and spoke model with multimodal logistics park. That is another attempt to that. They're talking of increasing the speed by strengthening the roads and the railway tracking system. That is another part to it. But the one more important part that we talk about, but we don't recognize it as a separate subject that needs to be integrated, is the administrative distance. The forms, regulations, performance, the rituals that we need to perform. The rules and regulations, the jurisprudence, if you are not happy or something goes wrong. The accreditations of the suppliers or the service provider, or the logistics service provider. The freight forwarder, the CHA, the container train operators, the Concord, the railways, the DFC, they are all the service providers, and how they are accredited. Is DFC can be called A plus today, or Concord can be called A plus today? Is freight forwarder XYZ an A plus category? That we need to know. Because we know when we eat by the roads side stalls, we can have a stomach upset, but we pay some peanuts compared to we go to a restaurant of a report. Similarly, when I know that I'm going to a accredited agency, that my kind of delivery would be this and the variability would be this. Cost is not an important issue. I know when I'm flying by an air, I am paying more. I'm not concerned about the cost, but I'm concerned about the air. If the air delay is more than an hour, then I have many things to lose. So the variability is today's key performance indicator in the logistics world. It is not the time and the cost, because if I agreed my time to be 5 days or 10 days, I've agreed to it. But 10 days should not be 15 days or 17 days. That is where it will pinch me. If I agreed that I will shift my ton, $1 per ton kilometer, it should be $1 and not that hidden cost built into it, and it becomes $1.25 by the time it reaches the end consumer. Hence, the administrative distance and the physical distance need to be brought together. And that is where the coordination lies. And the underlying philosophy behind the coordination is the trust. People do not mistrust the other. Otherwise, the administrative distance will go up. If the administrator who is checking my cargo or my document believes that I am hiding something, then it takes more time and more time to clear. And therefore, this relationship has to grow. This online real-time systems, RFID, online filing of documents, they are all the first step, but that does not bring in the trust that we have. The trust factor will come in when there is a transparency into it. Whatever I do, I tell you. Whatever the government does, he tells us. Whatever the consumer expects, he tells rightfully. If this transparency has to be brought in, then there are two ways that the trust can be tackled. One is transparency and other is the technology. Well, a lot of technology aspect has been spoken about. RFID, IoT, Industry 4.0. Of course, blockchain is a very good way to build in trust, because there is very, very difficult to tamper with the documents. And the most importantly, that I would say, the transparency and the visibility of the cargo and the communication between the different agencies are integrated. And this integrated can come through a logistics, integrated logistics platform. And what this platform is supposed to give us? This platform is supposed to give us that I seek a solution, that I want to move my cargo from Pathankot to Kochi. Should I go by sea? Should I go by rail? Should I take DFC? Should I go by truck and then go by rail or by rail then? All these solutions should be provided to me by the different solution providers at what cost. Then I should be able to choose key, which is my insurance policy that I choose from the insurance site or which is the best product that I choose from a Snapdeal site. I should be able to block the slot in the train, not for the particular wagon, but which train the train is leaving when? The Concord station. And what is my slot booking? And if you are building in 103 wagon train, how much time will it take to consolidate? If I am the first container to be provided there, then how long my container waits in the DFC terminal to get move out? So that is the question that I need to be raised. And hence this integrated solution should be able to enable us to give logistic solutions, help us in brainstorming and making policy recommendations to the government, and more specifically the grievance handling. For the last few days we have been meeting the exporters. The Special Secretary Logistics, Anant Swarupji, and the entire logistics division was with us for the whole day and we have been debating. The first and foremost thing that they say, that they have a lot of grievances where to tell, whom to say. And not only on the government side, because India is growing on the privatization mode and more private players are coming in. So one private player is complaining about another private player. So where do they go? They can come to the integrated digital platform. And more so in this case, I would say that instead of working only on a physical dedicated freight corridor, let us build a commodity and a logical freight corridor. Say for example, a perishable goods like shrimp and fish would require a prior clearance with priority compared to a non-perishable cargo. I'm not saying that has to be stopped and this has to be sent, but a corridor has to be created that my perishable goods get the due time to move out of the border or go to the final destination. And hence, we need to build a digital ecosystem. And the digital ecosystem is in place, but they are not integrated. We have GSTN network, we have e-way bill online, we have the transporters online systems. We can integrate these three. Online transporter system can integrate with the vehicle database, that is Vahan. The vehicle which has been driven by a driver can be integrated with Sarthi database, and they can be integrated with the road transport offices in the state, and the road, and all these can be integrated to customs and the port. Port already has a PCS. We are not devoid of the EDI systems in the country, but all we act are in silo. We need an integrated digital ecosystem. That is where my emphasis and my research work goes on. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sinha. You raised a very valid point about trust, and I hope the audience also have a trust that this program will end in time. So we have got another 5 more minutes left. So if there are any questions which the audience would like to ask to the panel.
We had a traditional system, one side, you know, suppliers, then there is a manufacturing, and then there is a warehouse, then a retailer, and the customer. This is the normal layout of any supply chain. I personally feel there is going to be a big change with lot of, you know, online businesses like Amazon, for example. The entire supply chain is, I personally feel, is going to change. So how do you think it will change? And what happens to the warehouses? What happens to mass production of the items? And then storing them and waiting for the, you know, mass orders, then full truck load can be loaded and can be sent there. So how do you see the future? With the online, everything becoming online and real time.
Right. So earlier, we used to have a single channel of sales. And that was that the manufacturing unit used to produce en masse, as you said, would go to warehouse. We would wait for the complete orders to be there. Then a full truck load used to go to a particular distributor or a wholesaler. Now the channels which are there have become multiple. So they would be B2C, they would be B2B, and they could be a very different channel. Say, like in our case, we have certain food channels which we send for PVRs and other, where you have a different MRP products. They would be manufactured from a single unit, but they would have a different distribution channel. And you have to adapt to that. So I can't say that if there is a requirement of Pepsi by a consumer, it cannot be delivered in single bottle or it has to be a full truckload. So imagine if you require at your home and you need one bottle of Pepsi and I send you a truck of Pepsi. So that's not possible. So I need to deliver through that. And that is what is breaking the entire traditional trade's hold on to the consumer. But it will not go, it's not going to die down. Not everything is going to be on e-commerce. They would be, and I'm telling you, I started my career in the corporate with Reliance Retail. And when we started opening retail outlets across the India, everyone thought Mr. Mukesh Ambani is going to take away everything and all these pop and mom stores and, you know, they are going to shut down. And eventually when the e-commerce came in, they said this is the final end of it. I can tell you, and there are a lot of youngsters who buy when I was working with Nike, it came out that there's a lot of clicks onto the e-commerce platform. Eventually, the buying is happening at the shop as well. So this is going to happen and this mismatch is going to happen. Supply chain per se, when you're asking that question, will tailor make itself for this particular requirement. So where there is a truckload, that is going to be truckload, and where there is a single requirement, that will go. Probably they all may go into the same truckload. So I'll give you one example. Currently, there are two cars which are being manufactured in India of rival companies, but from the same assembly line. So you have Nissan, which produces Terrano, and then you have another car, which is called Duster, which is a rival car in the market, but they're using the same assembly line. So that is when the, your, you know, you have two different set of companies. Here I'm talking about the product of the same company going to multiple channels. So I'll just give you one example. When we produce Pepsi for a particular sales channel, it can be for traditional trade. You'll find it for 25 rupees. But if you want to have it in the airport, the MRP is different. The pack size is different. So that is what is produced on the same line. Distributed through the same channel, kept in the same warehouses, but at the last mile, the way of delivery changes.
Yeah. So, thank you. Yeah.
So, good evening. Actually, we have been talking from the morning about the last mile connectivity, but I never knew it would be so interesting in the last session as well. So thanks for a wonderful session. My question first to Holkar is, number one, about the consumer behavior. You have really hit the bullseye, telling that the consumer is the king, actually. The consumer takes all the call, irrespective of the cascade or which vertical the logistics are about. But I think the organization also gone one step ahead. Rather, what they're doing, it actually, they are teaching the consumer behavior what it's all about. Like, for example, initially we had, you know, the mobile button system. Today we have touch system. See, this is basically the thought. If you go for touch system, because you know the sensitivity analysis, they made it so well, intelligence through, that the touch is the feel which comes from the womb of the mother. It's not the hearing but touch. So they have understood the consumer's behavior very well and they taught to the consumer this feel that is going to future about it. That how the consumer behavior comes into.
I'll just add one line to this. Hum puri mehne mehnat karke jo paisa kamate hai na, the other side of the companies are just waiting for to take this revenue. Yeah. So they will come out and entice you with every possible way, a new model of phone, new model of car, new technology, new taste, new color, new fabric. So that is what the competition is all about. You know, how will Coke beat me in my game is by bringing a cheaper product at a much different taste.
I have one more last question, Mr. Yeah. Rajkiran. I think you really well touched actually the point of both competitive analysis which you made with the JNPT and the Adanis. So JNPT is of course there for almost from since 1930-40, but they not really made the industrialization despite of the scope they had it actually. But on the other hand, Adanis have made it despite of, you know, within 15 to 20 years of time. The reason being actually, you know, industrialization of the corporate in the government sector, it came only after 2015. But Adanis, they basically they took the SEZ they went out with their industrialization much before even the government. So now we started realizing the government coming into the forefront. Whereas Adanis are coming, they're grown up with the industries, but particularly from the context of SEZ. So I just wanted to add to your context is at the ball. Thank you.
So thank you so much, everybody. With this, we are about to close this session. The conclusion which we can draw from the discussion and the deliberation which we had is that the future of logistics in the world would depend on, one, which is infrastructure, two, is on innovation, three, is on intelligence decisions, intelligent machines, and fourth and the last is all about integration, be it physical integration, be it digital integration, or be it the integration of trust. So with this, thank you so much, everybody, and have a nice day.
Many thanks to our esteemed panel, ladies and gentlemen. Let's hear it once again for this enlightening tech talk. And now request our esteemed chair, Shri Anant Swarup, to kindly felicitate the panel with a small token of our appreciation. Shri Ved Prakash. Srimati Rajini Hasija. A round of applause, please. Thank you. Shri Atul Holkar. My apologies, Colonel Atul Holkar. Shri Rajkiran Kanagala. And Dr. Deepankar Sinha. I request Ms. Richa Chakravarti from EIG to kindly felicitate the esteemed chair.